Hello and welcome to the Practice Parlour. I'm here today with my friend and colleague, Rebecca L. Hargrove. Welcome, Rebecca.
Hey, Gina.
Rebecca is a singer with me in National Chorale. She has also performed with the Metropolitan Opera in Porgy and Bess. She is an actress and a model, and she is here today to talk all about her multifaceted career and how not to put yourself in a box.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I should have you like intro me every day. Every day.
So, Rebecca, if you could please tell everyone about your journey. How did you get to becoming this accomplished singer and this accomplished multifaceted artist?
Wow. You know, I think I just followed life. When you go to school for this very specialized thing, I mean, we're voice performance majors in conservatories and music programs, and I went to a performing arts high school before then. So for a lot of my life, I was being told, you're a singer, you're a soprano, and these are your five arias, go at it. And as great as that was, and I felt like my voice naturally took to opera anyway, so I was like, great, this is something I'm good at, for sure. I always felt like, this can't just be it. And, you know, I did my undergrad at Oberlin. I did my master's at the New School. And after I graduated, I had no jobs, truly. I maybe applied to like 20 companies, had a handful of live auditions and no offers. And so I was working a day job for the first few years out of school and just hitting the grind, hitting the audition circuit. And a few months out of school, I ended up booking a musical at New York City Center. And little did I know, half the cast was established Broadway performers. And they were the ones that really encouraged me to say, hey, like, none of us in theater just do one thing. You know, I'm working with Norm Lewis, who at the time was still working on Scandal while he was in our show. And he was like, yeah, you know, I'm in the show, I'm singing, but I'm about to go out to LA soon and shoot Scandal. Like, a lot of people were like, oh, we do commercial work, or we're in TV and film, like, we're in dance class, we're multi. You got to be able to do more than one thing. And so that's where I first got that light bulb moment, like, oh, well, of course, I've always loved and wanted to act, but that's just not where my training took me. So I was like, well, you're an adult, get in acting classes. And really after that show is when I got reps and the commercial and modeling work started flowing in. And so it really became a multifaceted career path after that show.
Yeah, so I feel like as opera singers or as classical singers, mm-hmm. we are often told that we have to cultivate our voices to the best of our ability, almost at the expense of everything else. Like the acting is always secondary to the voice.
Yeah.
And I feel like in the musical theater world, that's not always the case because musical theater really approaches it from an acting first standpoint. And so there might be more crossover between musical theater and doing plays or doing film and TV. But for an opera singer to do all of those things, it's much more unusual.
Yeah. And I've actually been finding that the more and more I hit the audition circuit and meet more people, there are a lot of opera singers that do film, especially voiceover. And when I found that out, I was like, duh, you have a voice performance degree. Not like, oh, you have an only sing opera degree. Yeah, like, yeah, duh, I can apply the same technique to other facets of using my voice. But I've come across quite a few. Even I'm quarantining here in Maryland, and my piano tuner comes and is like, oh, you sang at the Met. Well, I tune another woman's piano that she just retired from the Met a few years ago. And I go Google her, and the first thing that comes up is a short film she did. So, you know, like, we're definitely the minority but it's not as unusual. I'm finding the more I do it.
That's so great to hear. Mm-hmm. So how do you find yourself balancing it all, keeping up your vocal technique and your voice training and your skills in that area with all the other things you do?
Yeah, it's tough. It's not easy because when one thing is going really well, I'll say like 2017 was a year. 2017 was a good year. 2018 was a year where all I was doing was film work. And so with that, I was very invested in my acting classes, very, you know, the same way I would have a voice lesson or a coaching every week, I was in my acting classes every week. And so my voice teacher at the time said, listen, it's like a stove. Not all the eyes are going to be hot at the same time. So you got to put your pot on the eye that's hot. So I find that, and it works for me now, who knows if it'll work for me later, but whatever is the most immediate thing that needs attention gets my full attention. So if I'm working on a film, I give the film my full attention. You know, if I'm even in my classes, I try to say like, okay, well, I have a scene to learn. I'm going to give these dedicated hours to that scene. I have music to learn. I'm going to give these dedicated hours to that music, but I can't try to like do them all at the same time. It never works that way.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
So how do you feel your vocal training has helped your other endeavors and vice versa? How have the other things helped your stage work?
First and foremost, I'll say there's something very particular to the way we are trained as opera singers and like pressure cooker environments that I'm very used to someone saying, learn all of Act Three, Bohem, you got a week, go. You know, and I want it memorized. I want it like performance ready, right? So when someone's like, here are these sides, I need you to learn these lines like right now, because I have such an extensive training in the memorization of music, like memorizing lines and scenes and things like that come very easily to me. And the pressure of having to do it in a short amount of time is like, okay. You know, like I did a tape the other night. I might've looked at the lines like two or three times. And I was like, all right, let's record it. Let's go. Yeah, like my photographic memory from photographing music in my mind, like I had the lines in my head, you know? So I appreciate that part of the training. And then you said, how does it translate? Funny. So when we were doing Porgy, I started noticing, because at the same time I was working on Evita at City Center. And like you said, in musical theater, it's the acting first, then the music is grounded in the acting, whereas in opera, it's the music first, and then, and then, you know, like, sure, hopefully whatever comes out performance-wise will reflect that. And I remember looking around the room, and we were in a funeral scene, and some people, it was like a range between, I'm just watching the soloist, I have like nothing reading upon my face, but I might be making the most beautiful sounds on earth. Or, oh, it's like over, you know, like finding the medium, which I think is where theater really lives. And like, you know, these stories are always grandiose and you're like, gosh, that isn't my real life story. And I think more contemporary theater is more grounded in reality. But for the most part, you're like, yeah, these are outrageous stories, but the authenticity of the scene always has to be there. And I noticed like sometimes in opera, like because the stories are so outrageous, it's like normal for the authenticity to not be there. But after like training in theater, I'm like, oh, this is what they mean. Like when people talk about opera singers, like this is what they mean. Yeah. So it helped ground my performances more. I'll say that.
I feel like there is a trend, at least more so now though, to pay attention to the acting and to the text, yeah, and the storytelling. Mm-hmm. And while the voice might still take precedence, I think there's definitely at least certain people that I've worked with, certain directors and collaborators who really are about the storytelling. Mm-hmm. And like, what is that fine line? How far can you go so that you still sing with your best technique and emotionally get to where you need to be?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, and the more new contemporary opera that comes out that once again is grounded and rooted in reality, it opens the door for your acting as a performer to also be grounded in that sense. But you know, I'm talking about like the outrageous stories that couldn't possibly happen in real life. Like, I can't, like, off the top of my head, but you know what I mean, right? Like the more classical era stories that have nothing to do with what's happening in 2020.
Yes.
Yeah. But yeah, I do appreciate when working with directors in opera and they want to talk about character and not in a, okay, you stand here, you stand there. But like, okay, you're standing there. So why would you be there? Where did you come from? What's happening in the scene? Where are we going? Where, like, that I do appreciate. There is more of that, thank God.
Yes. So speaking of 2020, I remember seeing on your social media, you had a whole setup. I don't know what you were filming, but you had this whole setup of the cameras and the desk and the sets. And I would love to know more about that and how you are getting along in 2020.
Ooh, 2020 has been a year for us all. But I personally have had a lot of silver linings about this year, and they're, of course, there are a lot of things to be upset and angry and sad and unsettled about. But in my own life, trying to stay positive, right? Because, I mean, we all had jobs that were just completely interrupted. But also, being home has been able to open up some opportunities that I could have never done, like the shoot you're talking about. So that was a commercial shoot for this company called McKinsey. And I can't speak any more on it than that, but I can tell you about it. So basically, when I booked it, a huge part of being able to book it was being able to transform your home essentially into a set. And there's no way I could have done this in my one bedroom apartment uptown. So the best part about being home was that my mom's living room was perfect. So I think a large part of me booking it, not just like learning the lines and submitting a tape, was there were about four or five different rounds where I had to Zoom with the producers and give them a tour of my entire house. Like, this is this room, okay. And then there would be another Zoom. We'd be like, okay, great, we like that room. Can you pull out measuring tape and like measure the walls, this wall to that wall, this to that? And what's the likelihood of you being able to move all this furniture out? Because they shipped all the furniture set pieces. They shipped all the lights, the cameras, the microphones, the reflectors, the booms, the everything got shipped to me. And it took me a week to set it up, and we shot it all in one day.
My jaw's on the floor. I mean, as an opera singer, did you ever think you'd have to do something like that?
Never, never. And not even as an actor. Like, my appreciation for every single person, every single stagehand, grip, tech, PA, wardrobe, hair, makeup, like I had to do everything. They shipped me the clothes, and they shipped me the clothes and a steamer. You know, they're like, oh yeah, and you steam them out. Do your own hair and makeup. We trust you. Thank God I had my fiance and my mom, but it was a lot of stuff you never have to think about.
So how are you keeping your positivity and looking at this with gratitude versus feeling completely overwhelmed, completely like, now our job description has expanded a million fold. How are you, I guess, what's your mindset like on everything right now?
Yes, I'm always trying to operate from a place of gratitude. And I, like the next person, have so many things to complain about. But the core of it all is I moved from my home 7 years ago. So this would have been my 7 year anniversary of living in New York. In those 7 years, I haven't been able to come home for like more than 4 or 5 days at a time. Because when I was in school, it's like, I gotta rush back to school. And after that it was, oh, I work Monday through Friday and the weekends, that's such a quick turnaround if I come home for a weekend. So I haven't spent this much time at home, like quality time with my family, quality time with my fiance, that he would be at work, I would be at work, and now we're just like in here, like, oh, you're you, you know, like, you're you, I'm me. We've like never spent this much quality daily time together. And taking time to get to know my in-laws better. We bop between my mom's house and their house. And I'm grateful for that. You know, now having that time, I couldn't imagine if I just kept living my life, like experiencing life in between the gig, in between the work, in between this event to this event is when I squeeze my family in. So I'm completely grateful for that. Like, I do not wish we had this virus, but I'm glad we had this shutdown time. I never felt guilty because it wasn't like I was missing anything. You know, like, could just be here and be.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
What do you feel going forward in terms of your own career and in terms of what you have learned to do, what might be asked of you to do? Like, what excites you?
I'm really excited. I'm excited, especially with TV and film slowly opening up. And after doing that in-home commercial, to get back on a set with all the things I've been able to learn here and all of the connections I've been able to make virtually, be it. But I'm excited to implement those in whatever the real world looks like again. And as a singer, I'm excited to see what art is going to come out of this, right? Like, there have been so many virtual projects, so much is happening with social justice and all these conversations, and proud member of the newly formed Black Opera Alliance, and seeing what to me is a small group. It's about 500 plus singers. And I'm like, that's a small group of Black singers, but all of us collectively together are a force and have been able to, you know, enact some real change in these opera companies. And I'm excited to see things open up where the theater might actually reflect the world we live in, you know? So I'm once again being hopeful that things won't just go back to the status quo.
Yes. I love that. I think it's true. This year has been so hard for all of us. And, you know, particularly for, you know, if people have been ill or have had personal connections to things, you know, it's been really, really hard. But there is so much possibility for better.
Yeah.
And that is exciting.
Yeah. I've had a lot of awesome conversations with friends that I don't think I would have normally, once again, have the time to have, or have the energy to have if we were still in our very busy work life schedule. So that excites me that there's a lot of discourse and change and influence happening right now. And yeah, it's palpable.
So in terms of your habits and routines, pre-pandemic and now, can you share a bit about your self-care practices, whether it be for your voice or your art or just your daily life?
Yeah. Pre-COVID, I was on tour, and tour is fun, but there's also this added pressure of having to maintain the voice in different climates. And as an adult, traveling more, obviously when I was a kid and I was in college, like you're in college, you're in this one place for 4 years and your body acclimates to that place. And then you become a professional adult working artist and you're like, well, I'm in Phoenix one day and I'm in San Diego the next. I'm going through different elevations. I'm going through like learning my instrument in that way. So on tour, let's just say if I know I'm going like Denver, Phoenix, New Mexico area, Albuquerque area, I start adding in chlorophyll to my water to prepare the lungs for the elevation difference. I started personal training like 2 years ago on and off, which makes me feel better, but also helps me perform better and have the stamina. I have to do something physical before singing. And that's if I expect the singing to go well. You know, like I gotta stretch it, I gotta do yoga, I have to run, something to get the body going. And steaming before every performance. Even like my practice, I'll try to steam for like 10, 15 minutes. Because I typically practice first thing in the morning and then do a full warm up right before a show. So first thing in the morning, I'm like dehydrated. I haven't drank water. So I get the steam in there to just like get it going. Other than that, I battle with acid reflux. So I have to watch every single thing I eat, which sucks. So that's a part of my daily discipline, because some days I just want to have like spicy tomato, something or rather, and chase it with some red wine and have chocolate for dessert. It says no.
That's what you need.
Exactly. Like, I just know it's not going to go well. Like, take a Nexium and pray for the best. But yeah, so between like working out, trying to eat right, steam, my vitamins, what I put in my body, all those things play a hand in like my daily practice for success.
Do you find that the way you care for yourself as a singer and the way you care for yourself as an actor model, do you find that they align, or do you feel more pressure in one area than another?
When you say care for myself, mm-hmm. what do you mean?
Well, I guess all those practices that you just described, you're, you know, eating right and working out, and I guess, do you feel you just do it for you, or do you do it for, you know, your job, or how, I don't know, what's your relationship to all of that?
I get it. Okay. So, I think they're all hand in hand, right? Mm-hmm. As much as I would love to eat all the bad things, because all the bad things are my favorite things to eat, I have to keep in mind that I have to maintain the voice. And I think I worry more about maintaining the voice than like vanity maintaining the body, because a lot of the modeling that I do isn't fashion runway. I don't have to be a size zero, which is amazing, because I never have and I never will be. and I have been on certain gigs where I am the biggest one. And there have been situations where I have been made to feel insecure, or like things that I personally am insecure about are like pointed out as flaws. And I'm like, oh my gosh, like I'm full chested. I have full chest, I have broad shoulders, you know, and I've gotten in certain studio situations where they're like, we didn't buy anything that fits her. Like, even though I've sent my sizes in advance, like, oh, nothing fits her. It's just too tight here, too tight there, like too tight in the hips, too tight. Like, I don't have a stick figure body and I'm not gonna change it for anyone else. So I have to keep reminding myself when things like that happen, you sent your sizes in advance, they were aware, and it's their problem if they don't know how to shop for you. But it is very disheartening in the moment. You're just like, oh. I've held up many a set, like spent an hour in wardrobe because they can't figure out how to dress someone with large boobs, you know? or hips. It's the strangest thing ever. But I keep my body in whatever shape I can keep it in, because that is like the optimal shape for my singing. So if I'm doing a lot of cardio, I know that helps me with my breath support, which I'm like always daily striving to get better at support. So, you know, certain Pilates and yoga poses and singing in those poses and stretching in that way before I sing help me. If they also strengthen and tone my body, that's great too. So I try not to succumb to the pressures of doing it for someone else. I definitely do it for myself. And I know that in doing it for myself, I can only better my craft.
Love that.
Yeah.
So since you do so many different things, I'm wondering what helps you decide which kind of projects you want to take on? Do you have any, any guiding guidelines or values that help you make those decisions?
Let's see. I still belong to the school of, unless it's something I truly think my mom will be ashamed if she ever saw it, like, say yes to everything. Even if you think it's not, well, within reason. If there is something you know you physically cannot do, and you're not, and you accepting it would really just be setting yourself up for failure, then very graciously say no to that. But if you think this is an opportunity to challenge yourself and stretch yourself and see what you're made of, then say yes. 2 years ago, I did a world premiere of a one-woman opera called The Greyland, and that composer found me on Instagram. It was like the craziest thing. He just came across my Instagram page, went to my website, reached out, and the soprano that he had already hired for the world premiere, who coincidentally is a friend of mine from high school, she had to drop out at the last minute. And he was like, I need someone that can sing this 70-minute work. And oh, by the way, the premiere's in 5 weeks.
Oof.
Right. So I'm sitting here. My calendar is wide open. You have nothing going on for the next 5 weeks. And I took a look at the score and I said, well, you could say no and miss out on an opportunity to learn something and be a part of the creation of a piece just for the sake of saying, I don't think I can learn that in 5 weeks. Or you can challenge yourself to buckle down and get it done. And so that's what I did. And I was still working a day job, like 11 to 7, I would be at work. So I would get up at 6 a.m., warm up, learn a few pages at a time, go to work. My pianist would come over after work, go at it for a couple of hours. And that was every day for 5 weeks. Yeah.
Wow, that's intense.
Yeah, but it paid off. Like the premiere went well and his record label ended up green lighting us to record the album. So we recorded that album at the top of this year and it's coming out next month.
Amazing.
Yeah. So see, I could have turned that down and been like, oh, there's no way I can do this. So much pressure. But so much good came out of the pressure of it that I would have missed that complete opportunity. So I encourage people to just say yes and challenge yourself to rise to the occasion, you know?
That's great. So what kind of stories do you like to tell? Do you notice any threads or through lines in the stories you're drawn to?
I'm trying to think like across genres. I think period, I enjoy telling stories that resonate with me and my experience. As a woman, as a Black woman, it's so hard to see that representation in opera for sure. And yes, in film, but in a positive light, like not in a stereotypical kind of way. Like I love to see Black women doing things you wouldn't expect them to do, like, you know, being doctors, like how I love the show Blackish on ABC and you see Tracee Ellis Ross as a doctor, you know. I fell in love with the new Ricky Ian Gordon opera, Intimate Apparel. Were you able to catch that?
I didn't see it, and I'm still heartsick about it.
That's probably like one of the last shows I saw in a theater. It's based on the Lynn Nottage play, Intimate Apparel, which I read in college, did scenes from it before, so I was very familiar with it. And I had a chance to audition for it, so I heard the music, and I was just like, lush, like Ricky and Gordon, you know, just like soaring lines, beautiful music. And a lot of my friends were casted in it, so I went to see the full production when it was in previews. I want more. Like, write another one. I'm really excited for Terrence Blanchard's piece to come to the Met next season. I just want to see more representation of the holistic people that I know, that I see in real life. I want to see it on stage. So I'm connected to any story that like exalts the woman, exalts Black excellence. Give it to me.
I love that. And I love what you said about seeing holistic people. And I think, you know, this is airing in the Self-Care for Singers group. And I think that as singers, we need to think of ourselves more holistically as whole people. Mm-hmm. And then, as you said, see whole people represented on stage and in our art.
Yeah.
And so often we just see a little slice, or as you said, a stereotype, but to see fully realized humans is exciting.
It is, and it's almost jarring when you see it, because you're like, I didn't know I could see that, or I didn't see things in that way, you know? It really makes experiencing art so beautiful when you can see something and be like, I see me, or I learned something new from this piece.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, yeah. And I think also when you see you, then you also help other people to see themselves. It's like, I see myself in you and you see yourself in me.
Yeah.
So it creates empathy and understanding. And
truly, truly. I think that's what really, and we say music is a universal language. Art unites so many different cultures and backgrounds and experiences. But if people from different walks of life can look at the same thing and connect with it, then surely those people can connect with each other, you know?
So do you have any thoughts or maybe advice for people who are looking to explore different mediums about just that, about like it not being about the medium?
I think you have to really be in tune with your desires. For the longest, I allowed my teachers and my background to tell me what my desire should be. Same thing earlier, I was just saying like, oh, I have a degree in voice performance. Why don't I just perform with my voice? You know, so I woke up one day and I kind of really started struggling with just calling myself a singer or just calling myself an opera singer, because it really started to feel limiting. And I realized like, I just want to perform, and I'm happy if it's an opera, I'm happy if it's a musical, I'm happy if it's a play, I'm happy if it's on a set for a TV or film project. So get in tune with yourself. It took me like a while to realize that, because my mind told me I had to choose. We're always saying like, you have to pick one, you have to choose one. It's like, or you can do what makes you happy and do what you do best. So if you're a storyteller, how do you best tell stories? You know, start there. There's nothing that says you can't do voiceover if you are a singer. And that could be telling stories. The art of audiobooks, which who doesn't listen to podcasts or audiobooks? And that's just such an ingrained part of our culture now. So yeah, you really have to figure out what it is you want to explore. And I'll say for myself, once I kind of narrowed it down to, I know I want to act. I'm already a singer who acts through, you know, art, song, and opera, but I really want to get a technical grab on acting and not just performance acting. So I put myself in acting classes. I talked to my friends that I consider and regard highly in those fields. I have opera singer friends that also do voiceover. So I'm usually bugging them in their inboxes like, hey, can you tell me about this? Can you tell me about what kind of technology I need? Do I need an agent? Should I be in this class? Should I be networking with these people? You just kind of like tap into your network and your resources, because our resources are so wide and diverse and deep. You know, even in National Chorale, there are artists, I just offhandedly mentioned to one of our colleagues, like, oh yeah, I'm about to do Evita. And they're like, oh, I did Evita. You know, I'm like, what? You're like, and now I have another opera classical singer trained friend that I can talk to about crossing over. You know, you just reach out and find out who is an expert in what you want to become an expert in. And that can be your point of entry.
I love that. And I feel like the way you're describing it also really helps talk back to our imposter syndrome. Yep. I feel like it would be very easy to say, I would love to try the world of commercials, but I know nothing about it. Mm-hmm. And the learning curve is so steep. And who am I to go into that new world? So yeah, I feel like you've offered so many tools to maybe overcome that or talk back to that.
Yeah, and I think imposter syndrome, don't we all suffer from it? You know, that resonates with me. And I'm in a class right now, and one of my friends who is also a classically trained singer has crossed over to musical theater and now wants to get into TV film. We were reviewing each other's tapes, and they're just like, oh, well, what do you think? And I look up to this person. What do you think? And I was like, you're asking me? Because I look up to you. Like, no, we're all equals. We all have, you know, we all have something that we can help each other elevate and do our best at. But, you know, even somebody trying to go in the commercial world, I had it in my mind a lot when I thought of models. I thought America's Next Top Model. Emaciatedly thin, you know, very skinny, or blonde hair, blue eyed, you know, didn't know if there was a space for me, being black or being black, curly hair. Do I look black enough, or, you know, all of that stuff. And you just realize, like, you yourself are a person in the world. So there's space for you. like if you exist, then there is space for you on camera or in print, because they are marketing to the people of the world. And like, once that clicked, I was like, oh, okay. So yeah, I don't have the emaciatedly skinny, thin frame, like a runway model, but you're never gonna see that runway model in a Target ad, because moms in Missouri don't resonate with that.
Yes, I love what you said about there is space for you. And as singers, how much of our training is about expansion and claiming our space and taking up our space, not constricting and tightening and shrinking.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's sometimes it's so hard to remember, but it's the same lesson. It's like, take your space.
Truly. And people gravitate to the person that can walk in a room and own it. And then the person that walks in the room and isn't apologizing for their presence in the room, you make them uncomfortable. They're like, oh my God, I'm so uncomfortable. Can you please leave? Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, take your space.
Yes. So Rebecca, I have two parlor games, two questions that I ask all of my guests. Okay. And the first one is called Lighting the Candle. So is there a person, a resource, or an organization that you would like to illuminate?
Ooh. So right now I'm totally entrenched in this show called Lovecraft Country. I don't know anyone here has watched it. It's on HBO. It's fabulous. But the writer of the show, Misha Green, I have absolutely fallen in love with this woman through her writing and through her storytelling. And so I would like to light the candle and just say to viewers, like, look her up, look up her shows. Lovecraft is, I think, season finale this weekend, but she had another show called Underground on the WGN network. And it was actually one of that network's most successful shows, but it got bought out by a larger conglomerate and they decided to cancel her show without like letting them finish the narrative. And so she's kind of just been like on my radar as far as I said earlier, like Black women exalting holistic stories that aren't just for us, but tell the narrative and share the story from our perspective in a non-stereotypical way. So Misha Green.
Misha Green, thank you. We will look her up. And then my last question is called The Parrot. If we were all your parrots, what would you teach us to say?
Oh, wow. You know what? I would teach everyone to say, yes, queen. And then anytime I said something to you, I'll just be like, yes, queen. Yes, queen.
Yes, queen.
Yes, queen.
That's amazing. Yeah.
So even if I suck and I'm like, how did I sound? Yes, queen.
Yes, queen. Well, Rebecca Hargrove, you are a queen. You are our queen. And everybody, to all the ladies watching, you are also queens. And to the men, you are kings. And we adore you all. So thank you, everyone, for watching, for spending your day with us. And Rebecca L. Hargrove, thank you so much, dear friend, for visiting the Practice Parlour.
Thank you so much for having me, Gina.
Your vulnerability, your warmth, your spirit, you are such an inspiration in all that you do. So thank you for sharing your light today.
I appreciate you. Thank you so much for having me.
You're welcome. Have a beautiful day, everyone.
Bye, guys.